Welcome back, and in this lesson I want to continue the disaster recovery architecture series, this time looking at the disaster recovery considerations and resilience properties of some of the AWS compute services. Now again, this is going to be an important lesson to understand for the exam and for the real world. And it's also going to be completely visual, so let's jump in and get started. Because this lesson is focusing on compute, this time I'm going to stick to a single AWS region, which is US East 1. And as before, we're going to look at two availability zones at the top in blue, and one area in green at the bottom, which represents anything which is not specific to one individual availability zone. The reason I'm limiting this to one region is that when dealing with compute, all globally resilient architectures tend to have multiple independent regions of compute, and they use something global to distribute clients onto those regions. There are no truly global compute services available from AWS. Now, in the networking lesson in this series, I'm going to be demonstrating AWS products and services which can be used at a global level to direct incoming traffic to one or more AWS regions. But when you're looking solely at compute, you have to be focused on one particular region. So that's what we'll be doing in this lesson. Now let's start with EC2. An EC2 instance runs on one single EC2 host, which itself runs within one availability zone. That EC2 instance is presented with storage from the Elastic Block Store known as EBS, and this is in the form of an EBS volume which is running from that one particular availability zone. Now, what can go wrong with this architecture? Well, if the host fails, then the instance also fails. A host failure is always the smallest fault which can impact an EC2 instance, which is why EC2 isn't resilient in any way. There's always going to be some likelihood of an EC2 host failing or needing to be rebooted for updates, and so you should always assume that an EC2 instance will face some disruption. Now, if the failure is limited to one particular host, then an instance can move to an alternative host within that availability zone, and because EBS is also running within that same availability zone, and because it's external to the EC2 service, then assuming it is just a host failure, the EBS volume can be presented to that new host and that same instance running on that new host. That's why EBS offers significant advantages versus using Instance Store, because it's separate to the lifecycle of one particular EC2 host. But you have to be aware as a solutions architect that the storage volume itself is tied to that one particular availability zone. We have bigger problems if and when the availability zone fails, because then EBS is also impacted. If availability zone A failed in this example, then it's going to impact EBS running in that availability zone, meaning any instances on any hosts in that availability zone are also going to fail. That's why we group our architectures into fault domains, so that we can tolerate the failure of an availability zone. We need to make sure for this application that we also have infrastructure running in availability zone B, which can continue operating even with the failure of availability zone A. For EC2, this comes in the form of an auto-scaling group, set to run between, in this example, both availability zone A and availability zone B. This means that after the host and instance failure running in availability zone A, AWS can provision a new EC2 instance running on a new host, which crucially comes with its own EBS storage because it's in a separate availability zone. Auto-scaling groups are not actually migrating instances between availability zones. They create a new instance using a combination of launch templates, launch configurations, and AMIs, and the new instance is provisioned in this case in a brand new availability zone with its own storage. Now, this is a really crucial thing to understand about EC2. It's a product which is isolated to one particular availability zone. It runs on an EC2 host, which is in one availability zone. It uses storage, which is in one availability zone, and it uses networking, which is also in one availability zone. So if you have a an instance which architecturally fails over from AZA to AZB. What's actually happening is the instance in AZA is being terminated and a new instance is being provisioned in AZB. Now, the Elastic Container Service has similar architectural properties. It can run in two modes. The first is EC2 mode, in which case the containers are running on EC2 instances which are configured to be ECS hosts. If the EC2 host fails or the AZ fails, then the containers running on that host also fail. It can also run in Fargate mode, which is the mode where containers are provided in a serverless way. In reality, the containers are running on cluster hosts which AWS manage, and then the containers are injected into a VPC via an Elastic Network Interface which runs in a subnet which also runs in an availability zone. If the availability zone fails in Fargate mode, this means that the container fails, but if you've configured these to use services, you can also configure Fargate to automatically provide high availability by running things in different availability zones. Again, this is another compute service which shares a similar AZ isolated architecture. This is why availability zones are so important, because they're the basic failure domain of AWS. Now, we also have Lambda though, and this is slightly different. Lambda isn't by default a VPC-based service. It can run in private or public mode, with public being the default. In private, also known as VPC mode, it uses Elastic Network Interfaces which are injected into a VPC. If an availability zone fails, it can just move to another and start using that for connectivity. The function itself can run from underlying compute that's in any availability zone in that region, and as Lambda is stateless, every invocation can be different. In public mode, it doesn't have those dependencies of the Elastic Network Interfaces running in a VPC. It simply runs in the AWS public space. So in both cases, it would take the failure of an entire region to impact the Lambda service. Now again, just pause at this point and understand all of the concepts on this screen. You have to have an awareness of it for the exam and to be a professional level solutions architect. Understanding what happens if a host fails or an AZ fails will allow you to build resilient and best practice architectures, and it will allow you to do well in the exam. Now that is everything that I wanted to cover in this lesson, so just make sure that you really do understand it, and once you do, go ahead, complete the lesson, and I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.